Good morning, College Side family. Welcome to another online worship experience together. We are so thankful that you have chosen to be with us today. We're so thankful that you've been with us every week through this entire time that we have been apart. And we just want you to know how valuable we believe this time is. And we're working really hard to make sure that we put out the best experience for you, so that you can stay connected to your church family even when we're apart. We have several families that worship with us that may have never attended College Side before. We have several families that worship with us that have been attending College Side for years that are worshiping online right now. We want you to know how grateful we are, and we would love to hear from you, especially if you're worshiping with us and you've never attended College Side. We'd love to know who you are. We would love to reach out for you, not to put you on a mailing list or anything like that, but just to connect with you. Could you send us an email to sunday@collegeside.org? Anybody that's attending our online assembly, we would love to hear from you, where you're from, who you are, what your thoughts are. We're just thankful and grateful for you being with us. That's sunday@collegeside.org. We have several people that have been asking questions about what our plan is moving forward. We've said over and over that we plan to continue to put our best foot forward with our online experience, and we do plan to do that. As far as changes to the plan at College Side, whether it's people asking about when we're going to go back to one service or when Bible classes are going to come back, just know that our shepherds are meeting and praying over that, and we're watching what's happening in the world, especially with school starting back and Tennessee Tech starting back. And we want you to know that the plan is to continue where we are through August as we kind of see what happens with all the different schools coming back. And then we will we'll evaluate and hopefully make some decisions in the future as far as going back to a more normal schedule of what things look like before everything changed. Right now, our seniors are having their senior day at College Side, and it's just an abbreviated time with them at the end of our second service where we can honor them and celebrate them and congratulate them. And I know that not everybody can attend. And if you are at home and you want to send them a card or send them a letter of encouragement, check your bulletin that comes every week through our email or on our website, and send them a letter, send them a card, and let them know that you are excited for them as they move on to the next phase of their life. We are excited to have you with us, and we're excited to sing, we're excited to take communion together, and we're excited to hear another good lesson from God's Word. And we just thank you so much for being with us. Thank you for giving every week, and thank you for doing what you can from where you are to make sure that the kingdom continues to grow. We hope you have an awesome worship experience today.
Greater is the one who's in us. Greater is the one who calls our name. He will never fail. Stronger is the one within us. Stronger is the one who fights for us. For your love endures forever, oh, your love.
fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. And it's higher than the mountains that I face, and it's stronger than the power of the grave, and it's constant in the trial and the change. This one thing remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me.
Sometimes God works through unsuspecting people. Let me tell you a story today that starts with a woman named Naomi and her husband. Naomi and her husband were Israelites. They were children of God, and they lived in the promised land. And when they lived, God's people had been in the promised land for many years. But it was a bad time in the promised land. There had been no rain, which meant the crops did not grow. And that meant that the people had nothing to eat. So Naomi's husband and Naomi traveled out of the promised land to a foreign country. They traveled to a place called Moab. And there, they made their home, because in Moab they had food, and they were able to start a family, and they had one son, they had two sons, and their sons grew up, and they married women from the land of Moab. I'm sure this made Naomi a little bit sad, because it had always been important to the Israelites that their children marry other Israelites, marry people who worshiped only Yahweh, the one true God. But here they were living in a foreign land, and thankfully in that foreign land they were greeted with hospitality and they were welcomed and they were cared for. But things didn't always go well. Naomi's husband died. And so did both of her sons. And Naomi was left with her two daughter-in-laws, Ruth and Orpah. Now, Naomi had no way of caring for her daughter-in-law. She had no way of taking care of herself. And so she told her daughter-in-laws, I can't really take care of you. I'm going back to my homeland, to my family, to see if they will help me. But I can't promise you anything. So Orpah left. She went back to her own family. She found another husband who would provide for her. But Ruth refused to leave Naomi. Listen to the pledge of faith that she makes. In Ruth chapter 1, starting in verse 16. Don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if anything but death separates you and me. I wonder what inspired Ruth to make such a commitment. What inspired Ruth to have such faith? I wonder what she saw in Naomi's faith. I wonder what people see in your faith, in my faith. Do they see a God that they would trust their lives to? Naomi led Ruth back to the promised land, back to Israel. And when they got there, they didn't know what was going to happen. But God was with them. And God prepared a way for them. Ruth met a man named Boaz. And as she was working in his fields and collecting some of the food that had fallen to the ground to provide for herself and her mother-in-law. And Boaz had compassion on Ruth and Naomi. And Boaz took Ruth to be his wife. And this young woman, Ruth, not born one of God's people, but yet she became a very important person in the history of God's people, because she would have a grandson that many would know. His name would be David. I guess it doesn't always matter where we come from, does it? I wonder how our faith will impact the people that we meet. I wonder how your faith will impact generations to come, even generations you will never meet. May God work through us today, this week, and for generations to come.
Good morning. As we meet this morning, the coronavirus is still rampant throughout the world. We're in the middle of summer. School will be starting back soon. Lots of things are up in the air. And for a lot of people, that signals concern, that causes them to worry. But I'm here to tell you that God has this. God had it back in the first century when Christians were persecuted, when they were killed, tortured, kicked out of their countries. He had it in the Middle Ages when there was the plague. pestilence, wars, and he's got it now. So, whatever happens, God is in control. God is over all. Let's go to him in prayer. Father, we as humans have no idea about tomorrow. We have guesses, we have thoughts, we have maybes, we have hopes. But we know that you know it all. You know our tomorrow, our next day, our next year, and the year after that. And that you have it under control, that you are, that you will be, and that you have our best interest at heart. So, Father, at this time, we place our faith in you, place our hope in you, place our trust in you, knowing that you will make things better than we could possibly hope, dream, or imagine. Father, I pray at this time for those of our congregation who are suffering in any way, those who are sick, those who are ill, those who must remain isolated because of the coronavirus. I pray that you would heal them, help them, and lift them. Father, I pray for our leaders, both the leaders in our congregation, the leaders in our community, and the leaders in our country and in the world, that the decisions that they make, that they will make, are the right decisions, the best decisions, and those that keep us as safe as possible. Father, I pray that the despair and the anguish that each one of us feels can be dispersed, that we can be bathed in your love and your concern for each one of us, such that all fears vanish and that there is hope and that we can continue to walk on holding your hand. Father, I pray all these things in the name of your Son, Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
I see the work of your hands, galaxies spinning, a heavenly dance. Oh God, all that you are is so overwhelming. I hear the sound of your so overwhelming.
Good morning, College Side. I think a few thoughts that have been on my mind lately is just the faithfulness of God, even listening to John's lesson last night. And a song that just keeps going through my mind is Great Is Thy Faithfulness, and a lot of you guys know that song, but just the lyrics keep playing through my head, just, you know, Great Is Thy Faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have ever needed, you have provided, and great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Something that came up at Gulf Coast this year is this idea of being faithfully present. And it's really hitting me a lot now whenever I take communion, just the idea that I think the best gift that Jesus gave to us was his faithful presence. Just this idea that no matter where I am, no matter what happens in my life, no matter what circumstance I'm in, the Lord is continually present and faithfully present with me, regardless of what I go through. And that's huge, especially now, and not even realizing the this time and how long it's going to be. I see that the Lord is continually faithfully present, and that's enough. So I guess as we take this communion, just be thinking of that, thankful that regardless of what we do, regardless of what we're going through, that the Lord is continually present with us. So let's pray for the bread. Father, I just say thank you. God, I come to you having nothing to offer except just thanks. Thanks for what you've done, and because of your Son, that you are just faithfully present with us. God, I come to you with my shortcomings, my failures, and God, I lay them before you and realize that you are more than enough, that even now that you are present with me and present with us. So God, just thank you for your sacrifice and thank you for your love. And I pray in Jesus' name, amen. So let's pray for his blood now. Father, thank you for your blood. I thank you that you poured everything for us. So God, we look at this week ahead of us, and we commit it to you, realizing, God, that as you were faithfully present with us, God, so we must be faithfully present with you and with other people this week. So God, I pray that we see where we're at, and I pray that we commit ourselves to you, because God, this week is yours and our lives are yours. And I pray this in Jesus' name, amen.
The God of the heavens.
the Ancient of Days, the God of our fathers, and God of my friends, the Alpha Omega, beginning and end, forever and ever, your kingdom will stand. We come to bow before you.
Do you ever feel like there's one thing that's missing between you and success? Maybe you're playing a game with your friends or your family, and you're like, there's just this one move I could make that'd get me where I want to go. Or maybe it's a relationship that you're in, and everything seems to be clicking, but there's that one thing that if you just fix that, everything would be all right. In the world of sports, sometimes one point, one shot, one score could make the difference. I've been in games before where a double overtime game, actually this past year with the Tennessee Tech football team, we won a double overtime game by one score, and how awesome that was, that one score. But then just a few weeks later, we lost a double overtime game by one score, and how horrible that was. And so there's one point, one thing, one score that could make the difference. What if Jesus could look at you and say, I'll give you that one thing that you lack, and that would make the difference? In Luke chapter 18, there's a story that we often call the story of the rich young ruler. And it is a very popular story among the disciples because it was in Matthew's account, in Mark's account, and in Luke's account. At College Side, we have been going through a daily Bible reading through this whole year, and we're in the book of Luke right now. And if you're following that plan, you're going to be around chapter 18 in Luke. So we thought it'd be fitting to point back to what we're doing as far as our daily Bible reading and focus on a story that you would be reading right there. If you're reading something else, or maybe you've gotten a little off track, that's okay. Let's dig into this chapter anyway together and look at the story. Let's read Luke 18, and I want to start at verse 18. And a ruler asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. Do not commit adultery. Do not murder. Do not steal. Do not bear false witness. Honor your father and your mother." And he said back to Jesus, "All these I have kept from my youth." When Jesus heard this, he said to him, "One thing you still lack." So here's what it was. He told the young man, he said, "Sell all you have, give it to the poor, and you'll have treasure in heaven. Come and follow me." That was the one thing this guy lacked. Just one little bitty thing. Sell everything you got and then come follow me. When you look at this guy on the surface and you look at him, he is the ideal prospect. For those of us who are looking for someone to reach with the gospel, this guy's got it lined up. Look at what he's got. Number one, great character. He says he has kept the commandments since his youth. So you don't have someone who's way far away in their understanding of what's right and wrong. We can begin with a common standard. This guy's got great character. Number two, he's got great influence. He was rich and he was a ruler. We don't know exactly what he was the ruler of, but we think, according to scholars, they tell us that he probably was a ruler of a synagogue. And so he had influence among a crowd of people, among a circle of people. So if we could reach this guy, a guy like that, you could imagine the people that he could reach. So the ideal prospect, right? He had great potential. He was young. He was a young man. So think of all the time he's most likely got ahead of him. So it begins with that influence, and we could see that going out and thinking of the difference he could make. He's got great resources. He was rich. In fact, the scriptures say he was extremely rich. He had great possessions. So if he had great possessions, how could he use that money, those resources? Who was he plugged into? Think about what it could be. And then what we also learn in Mark's account, he's got a great attitude. Mark says, he includes a detail that Matthew and Luke do not, says he ran up to Jesus and knelt before him when he asked the question, "What must I do to inherit eternal life?" So he's got everything you would ever want in a seeker. And Jesus was seeking who he could save. He was looking for seekers. So I would think Jesus would see this is the evangelist's dream has shown up. So what's Jesus say? "I've got one thing for you. You need to go sell everything you got." I don't know about you, but that's something that would be difficult for me to say, especially to someone who seems like they've got it together. The Jewish mindset is similar to our mindset today, in that if this guy's got it going on and he's got everything figured out, he's got all these things, then God must be blessing him. And so this is probably what he's supposed to have. He's supposed to be in this position in life. But Jesus said, "No, you need to sell it all. You need to let it go." Well, was that the one thing he was missing? For him, obviously, Jesus says yes, but I would also say yes and no. And here's why. First of all, I know that it doesn't apply to me specifically for certain, because Jesus' words, we need to emphasize the word "you." One thing you still lack. Sell all your possessions. So he wasn't looking at Chip, he wasn't looking at you, he was looking at this man saying, "You need to sell your possessions." So it was a specific application for him. But the other thing that's interesting to know, is this really the one thing that everyone lacks? Luke chapter 10, verse 25, just a few chapters before, there was another man that came to Jesus and asked the exact same question. What must I do to inherit eternal life? Jesus didn't give the same answer. So this was specific to this man and specific to his circumstances. This is the one thing he was missing. And I would tell you, and as I reflected, I don't really believe Jesus was simply answering his question when he said this. What he was really doing is he was challenging the man's question. The man came up to him with this specific question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And he called Jesus good. And Jesus challenged his question. It's great that he was asking questions. It's great that anyone asks questions. God wants us to ask questions. That's how he gets us moving. But what was his question like? First of all, like him, we all begin with transactional questions. Transactional. It's much like a business agreement. I'll do this, you pay me that. Let's make the exchange, let's make the transaction. That's the kind of question he was asking. And that's normal to begin with questions like that. I began with questions like that when I was thinking about what job I would want when I'm coming out of college. I began with questions like that when I was thinking about a girl that I want to attract and want to look for, want to marry one day. I think about that with questions I might have in my life right now with people that I want to influence or people I want to be around. And we begin with transactional questions. So in a relationship context, I think, well, how can I attract that person? How can I get them to like me, to want me, to desire me? And I begin with that transaction of, if I do this, I'll get that. But seekers, true seekers of the Lord, begin to ask questions that are not transactional, but transitional. They transition to, maybe not, I don't begin with, how can I become attractive for someone else, but is there someone out there for me? Am I supposed to have relationships like that? Is there a job for me? Is there a career for me? Is there a situation that I am supposed to have? Does God have someone for me? So that's transitional. But really, God wants to bring us to what disciples ask. Disciples ask transformative questions. Transformative questions may be like this. Instead of, how can I attract someone else? Is there someone else out there? The transformative question is, how can I get to know what God wants? How do I get to know God? How do I look at the world the way God does? What does God want in me that he can use for those he sends into my life? Now we're looking from the inside out. Now it's not a transaction of, I do this, I get that. Now we're looking at what God can do. And that's exactly what Jesus was doing with this man, wasn't he? The man runs up, he kneels before him, and he says, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? What's Jesus say? Why do you call me good? Jesus begins to move him into different kind of thinking, and he invites the man on a journey. In the scriptures, we see people come to Jesus, and we can see consistent steps that people take to enter the kingdom, to come to Jesus. Now, these steps are given different terms, summarized different ways, so there's not a formula. We don't believe there's a formula of, I do this, I do this, I do this, and that's how I come to Jesus. But it's more like a journey. It's more like I've begun a road trip. Recently, my family, we took a little trip down to South Carolina, and just to get away by ourselves, and took a trip to the beach. And on the trip to the beach, there were stops along the way. So we got up, we got in the car, and we go for a certain amount of time, and you got to stop, and you got to go to the restroom. or you got to stop and you got to eat some lunch. I did not sit down before that trip and make a list of, okay, restroom break, lunch break, snack break, whatever. It wasn't a to-do list, was it? These were simply stops on the journey that you necessarily would have to make if you're going to your destination. So we look at the scriptures and we see that when we begin a journey with Jesus, there are steps that we tend to take. We're not talking about a formula to check off. We're looking more at those stops along the way. And I'd like to give you an easy way to remember those steps that come right out of this text. And there's five of them I see here, and they line up with the term steps, S-T-E-P-S. A good way to remember them. So the first one, Jesus invites this man on a journey and he tells him to start over. That's the first step, start over. Jesus challenged his thinking. He said, why do you call me good? What was he saying? You said good and it came out of your mouth. Do you really know what you said? Because only God is good. You're calling me good. Are you thinking about the words you're using? Are you thinking about the words you're using in your question? What must I do to inherit eternal life? The way this man was thinking at the time was he was already in the kingdom of God. He wanted to inherit, which means he wanted more. He wanted more of what could be out there. There's a difference between being a son, being in the family, and actually getting the inheritance and enjoying the inheritance. That's a process. That's something I step into. And so Jesus was saying, do you really know what you're saying? You're saying you can inherit something that you're not even in yet. You need to get to know God. You need to get to know who God is. So you need to start over and then come to the next step, trade up. You need to trade up. He says, no one is good except God alone. So Jesus was elevating his standards. That's what he was doing. This man came in, he said, here goes. I've done this, I've done this, I've done this. Probably more appropriately, he's saying, I have not done this. I have not done this. I have not done this. So what's keeping me from inheriting the full expression, the full enjoyment, the full experience of the kingdom of God? What's the one more thing I can do? And Jesus says, no, you need to bring your standards up. He says, you know the commandments. And so he gets him thinking about standards. But did he really know the commandments? Because the man responded and said, I've done all that since my youth, right? I've done every single one of them. If he really understood the commandments, the way Jesus teaches us the truth in the Sermon on the Mount, he would have said, guilty. Because like you and like me, we've not really fulfilled the commandments, have we? Jesus said, if you have anger in your heart, you've already committed a murder. Jesus said, if you have lust in your heart, you've already committed adultery. And so maybe superficially, maybe on the outside, maybe he'd not committed those acts outwardly, but what about inwardly? What about his heart? Really what he was doing, he was keeping the standard lower and Jesus was raising the standard. So Jesus said, trade up for a better standard, a better opportunity that's out there. But there's a problem, isn't there? When we trade up like that, we feel guilty. And so Jesus says the third step is you need to empty yourself. The ideal way for this man to empty himself, the best way for him to empty himself, is to let go of what he was holding on to that kept him from God. You know, we think about money and we hear this statement, and it's probably easy to say, well, what Jesus was saying is it's bad to have money. It's sinful to own possessions. You need to get rid of everything you have. We all need to take that vow and just get rid of everything we have. Is that true? If it was true, you wouldn't find anyone in the scriptures following God with any kind of possessions or any kind of money. And that's not true. You see it over and over and over. The problem here is what he was doing with his money. What is money, the place and the seat money had taken in his life? It had taken the center seat. There's a commentary that we can look at in 1 Timothy chapter 6, and this gives us the heart behind how we should handle money. Paul, writing to Timothy at the very end of the book, 1 Timothy 6, verse 17. Check this out. As for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, nor to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches. How good is that? Riches are uncertain. Do you know anything about uncertainty? I sure do right now, don't you? This world is very uncertain right now. And if it's doing anything for me right now, it's making me reassess what are the things that I'm holding on to that are uncertain, that I can't really know if they're going to be there or not. And the very next phrase that Paul uses, he says, don't set your hope on the uncertainty of riches, but on God. That's what Jesus was trying to get this man to do. Put your focus on God, not on what is uncertain. And he says, God, who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. So he's not talking about someone who needs to get rid of joy, and you need to take the vow of poverty and not have anything to your name. That's not what he's saying a Christian does. He's saying you need to get rid of everything and anything that would keep you from God, because God's the one that gave it to you in the first place. You're not treating it the way that God wants you to. And so verse 18 of 1 Timothy 6, he says, they are to do good, the rich are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share. That's why you have the riches in the first place, is to share it. Thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so they may take hold of that which is truly life. That's the key phrase. You can't take hold of something when you're holding on to something else. You can't take hold of true life when you're holding on to the things of this life that are going to be gone. I watch my dogs. My dogs are always like this. You always see this. You can see this in children too, when they want to hold on to something, but you can't pick up something else. And I see my dogs, I have two dogs, and one of them is kind of the hoarder, the one that everything's mine, you know? And if the other dog's picking up the toy, you know, this dog comes in and grabs it. Well, sometimes the dog gets into a little bit of a jam where you got something in its mouth and it's holding on to that, and the other dog has what it wants. Maybe it sees food or whatever, and it's like, okay, what do I do? I can't hold on to both things. If I let go of that, then the dog's going to get that. So I've got to make sure I hold on to this, but also grab that. Isn't that the way we are in life so often? I want true life. I want to be with God. I want to inherit everything that He has for me to experience. But my hands are holding on tight to something here. Jesus says, let go, empty yourself, empty your pockets, empty what you're holding on to, so you can really take hold of life. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, for we are saved, how? Through faith, by grace, not of works, lest any man should boast. You can't hold on to what you can do and take hold of the grace of God. When this man said, what can I do? He's saying, I want to hold on to what I can do. And so, the fourth step is to pursue the Savior. You can't pursue the Savior until you let go of something else. Well, now you can, and you need to turn to the real solution. So Ephesians 2 says, by grace you have been saved through faith. So this salvation is free, but it does have conditions. There is still something I must do, but it's something I must embrace. I must embrace the Savior, the one who died for me, the one who gave His life for me, the one who is far above me, the one who actually did earn my salvation, and I can't. And then I quickly go to the last step, because they go hand in hand, pursue the Savior and then submit to His leadership. You see, so often we want the saving part of Jesus, but we don't want his lordship. We want to call him Savior, but do we want to call him Lord? And really, at the heart of it, this is the difficulty this young man had, and I share it with him at times in my life. Do I really want to do what Jesus wants me to do? I'm the stereotypical man. I am. I get the box in the mail of the equipment that I'm going to use, and I got some doorknobs the other day. And I'm going to put these doorknobs on this door. I rip it open, I take it out, I look at the doorknobs, all right, let's figure this out and let's put this thing on. And it was a different kind of doorknob that I dealt with before, so I'm trying to put it on, and when I put it on, I'm getting myself in a jam now. What am I going to do? And then it occurred to me, oh yeah, there's probably some instructions. So I go back to the box, and I look, and there's that sheet of instructions, and I could have saved myself so much time if I would have looked at the instructions first. But that's not how I operate. I think about, what can I do? How can I figure it out? Following Jesus is following his instructions, is doing what he says. It's submitting to him, submitting my life to him. And that's where Jesus was taking this man. At the last part of the chapter, the young man became sad. Verse 23 of Luke 18. When he heard these things, he became very sad because he was extremely rich. Jesus, seeing that he had become sad, he said to his disciples, and he had this discussion, how difficult it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And there's your key. He hadn't entered yet. And he said, it's a lot like a camel trying to get itself through the eye of a needle. The biggest animal that they could imagine in their region trying to get itself right through this tiny, tiny little space of the eye of a needle. And they interpreted his words correctly because they looked at him and said, then how could someone be saved? That's impossible. What you're saying, it's impossible. And Jesus says, yes, it is impossible with man, but it's possible with God. When you think transactionally, when you think, I need to do this and I'll get this, it is impossible. You'll never get to God. But if you think transformatively, with transformational thinking, then you can think about what God can do. Where are you at on the journey? Where does he want to take you next? What is the next step? Do you need to start over? There's no shame in that. If we're going to come to God, we need to be born again, Jesus said to Nicodemus in John chapter 3. You need to start over. Do you need to trade up? Have you been keeping the standards too low? Is it time to elevate the standards so that then you can empty yourself and say, I'm guilty, I need you? And then turn to the Savior, pursue him. He's the only solution. He's the only one that can save me. But then submit to what he says. Do what he says. Where are you on that journey? We're all on that journey. If you haven't submitted your life to him, we want to encourage you to do that. It's time to do that. Maybe you need to work back through the process. We'd love to study with you and help you see that. Reach out to us. We'd love to help you do that. If you're at that point of submitting to him, the way you do that is by faith. I embrace Jesus and I say, I believe that he truly did die for me. He is good. He is holy. But he took on the penalty that I deserve. And then he was buried. And he rose from the dead on the third day. And so he lives forever. He lives to reign. He lives on his throne. And now he directs my life. And the way I embrace that is by repentance and baptism. I turn from my old life and I turn to him. I'm buried with him in baptism, and are raised to walk in newness of life. We want to help you take your next steps on your journey. Let's pray together as we finish. Our Father in heaven, we're just so thankful for the opportunity to sit in front of your word again. How awesome it is. Each and every story that we read in your word is so precious, but this is one that can hit us right where we are. And God, I pray that whoever is listening to this right now, I pray that you would speak into their heart. Let them hear the words that you want them to hear right now from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Whatever he's asking us to do, give us the courage to take that next step, to move toward him and not away, to move away from the things that we've tended to hold on to in this life and move toward our Savior, toward our Lord. We thank you. In his name we pray. Amen.